Last week, Angular version 20 was released. And unlike the previous releases, which were packed with innovation and gave us lots of new features and APIs, this version seems to be more about stability, which does not mean that there's nothing new in it. There is. But it's not as groundbreaking, at least it feels to me, as the previous versions have been. And therefore, I'll go through that official Angular 20 release blog post to highlight the important parts from my perspective, but therefore, I'll start with the change that's probably most visible when you start a new Angular project. It's not necessarily the most important thing that changed with Angular 20, but one of the most visible changes. Because the naming convention of Angular components, directives, and so on changed. Or the recommended naming convention, I should say, because of course, it's up to you how you want to name your components and directives. But if you do create a new Angular project with Angular CLI version 20 or higher, then you'll see that in there you have components that are named app.ts instead of app.component.ts. And the class name is also just app and not app component, for example. And it's the same if you then create new components with the CLI, with ng-generate. The components you get are just your component name, .css, .html, .ts, and the class name then also is without component, for example. And that's a big change because since the release of Angular 2 many, many years ago, almost 10 years ago, wow, how time flies. So since then, the naming convention has been app.component.ts, and the class name would have been named app component, and the same for the CSS files and so on. So that has been changed now because, of course, after 10 years, you might want to revisit your recommendations and the style guide updates. But of course, pretty much all Angular projects out there will probably be using the old naming convention. So I would guess it takes some time for the new convention to propagate through the Angular ecosystem and projects. And of course, it is up to you how you name your files. This does not impact the code or how the code executes, of course. If you want to get the old naming convention back when using the Angular CLI for generating components and directives, you can also do that, by the way. You can tweak your Angular JSON file and add this configuration to it, which I did here, for example. I added this block to my angular.json file. And if you do that, and you then generate components with ng-generate component and so on, you will get components that have that old class name and old file name. So you can get that back if you want to, and of course you can always name your files whatever you want. But that is one thing you might notice when you create a new Angular project and when you create new components in there. One other thing you might notice is that when you do create a new project, you get asked whether you want to use zoneless mode, if you want to create a zoneless Angular project. Because zoneless has been promoted to developer preview. Before that, it was marked as experimental, but now it is in developer preview mode. And zoneless, which I do cover in detail, like all of these important Angular parts in my Angular course, by the way, so I already do cover zoneless mode in there as well, because it is a very useful mode for optimizing the performance of your Angular application. Because in zoneless mode, there is one dependency less that must be included into the project, zone.js, and there are less checks that need to be performed behind the scenes. So not using zone.js, using zoneless mode can improve the performance of your Angular application. It's worth noting, though, that it's only available if you're working with signals, because it requires signals to tell Angular when something changed and when the UI should update. If you're not using signals, if you're using the old change detection mode, essentially, then you need zone.js. But if you are using signals, you can use zoneless mode. And now you get asked whether you do want to use it whenever you create a new project. It's still not stable yet, but it's also not experimental anymore, instead in developer preview, and we can probably expect it to be stable in the next major Angular version. Speaking of stability, as I mentioned, lots of other parts of this new Angular version are about stabilizing things, like, for example, the effect, linked signal, and toSignal functions that have been introduced with older Angular versions. For example, effect allows you to run some arbitrary code whenever some signal value changes. And these functions, therefore, have already existed, but now they're no longer experimental, no longer in developer preview. Instead, they're stable, which means they won't change in a fundamental way anymore in the near future. And that's, of course, good to know and have. Also marked as stable have been many parts of the Angular server-side rendering story. Angular does offer you some functions that allow you to set up your Angular project to be rendered on the server for every incoming request, for example. It gives you functions to then opt into incremental hydration, which, for example, means that parts of the page can be hydrated as it's needed. And all this has been introduced with previous Angular versions already, but now that's also all marked as stable, which means no drastic changes are to be expected in the near future. And therefore, if you're building an Angular application that needs server-side rendering, that's of course also good to know. You can now use all these different server-side rendering APIs without expecting fundamental changes. Now, there also have been some new things, some new features that were introduced with this new version. Most importantly, we got some new experimental signal-related APIs, like the resource function, which you can use in your components now. And the idea behind resource is that you can use this function to wrap some code that will fetch some data. For example, by sending an HTTP request, but we could also be reaching out to local storage here, or do any other thing that we need to do to fetch some data. And specifically, we're talking about fetching some data when some signal value changes. That's the idea behind resource here. And that's, of course, a common scenario. You might have a form that gets submitted, and when it does get submitted, some signal changes. And when that happens, you previously would have written some code that goes ahead, fetches the data, then updates some signal to expose the data to the template, and then Angular would re-render the template and update the UI with that fetched data. You can still do that, nothing wrong with this approach, but you can alternatively also play around with this new resource function to define a loader that contains the code that should run whenever some signal changes. And when I say some signal, then it's the signal you specify here in params. So for example, here in this demo, in this example, in the official announcement blog post, there is a user ID signal mentioned here in the params configuration of the resource function. And that tells Angular that whenever this user ID signal value changes, the loader function should run again. And that loader function will get the updated ID in this case here, and will then, in this example, fetch data from some server based on that ID. And therefore, in this example, whenever the user ID changes, a new request would be sent, and the result of that request, and that's the interesting part, would be exposed as a return value by resource, and that would also be a signal. So you could use that in your template to then use that fetched data and have the template, have the UI be updated by Angular whenever that data changes. Now, if we're talking about the use case where you do send an HTTP request, as it's the case here in this example, then you can actually use an alternative to this resource function. You can use the dedicated HTTP resource function, which is also introduced by Angular, also in experimental status for now. And that's simply just a simplified version of the resource function that is fine-tuned for dealing with HTTP requests and for helping you with sending those requests, extracting the response, and so on. So that could be a nice alternative to using the Angular HTTP client and setting up the code for sending that request manually. However, it's worth noting that, of course, it's in experimental status, so it could change. And of course, there might be scenarios where you want full control, where you want to control the entire code, where you want to do extra checks with the result or do more complex transformations, and where you might not want to use this new API, but it's definitely interesting and might be worth a closer look. There also have been some other additions to the Angular framework. For example, if you're creating a component dynamically with the create component function that is available in Angular, it's now a bit easier to provide directives to that component and bindings. So if you know that some directive needs to be used in that dynamically created component, it's now easier to tell Angular that it should create a component dynamically that is able to use certain directives. Definitely a bit of a more advanced use case, but if you have use cases like this in your project, your life will get a bit easier with Angular 20. There also are some new template features. Most importantly, maybe you can use the exponential operator, double asterisks now directly in your template. Or if you want to check if a certain key exists in some object, you can now use the in operator as you see it here. So also some nice quality of life improvements here. Now, related to Angular templates, it's worth noting that we don't just have new features or stable features, but we also have some deprecated features. Because with Angular 20, ngif, ng4, and ngswitch are marked as deprecated. And the idea is that instead of using those old structural directives, you use the relatively new template control flow blocks. So those blocks that were introduced with version 17, the @if and @for blocks for rendering code conditionally or for looping through content and rendering something for every piece. So if you're still using ngif, ng4, and so on, you might want to consider switching to the new control flow block syntax that was introduced with version 17. Now, the ngif, ng4, and ngswitch directives are still available. Deprecated does not mean removed, but they will very likely be removed in some future major Angular version, and therefore, as mentioned, you might want to consider switching to the more modern control flow block syntax. And that's essentially it. Of course, there's a bit more in there. For example, that vtest for testing is now supported, and that's why I do link the entire blog post below this video so that you can dive into all the details if you want to. But overall, my impression of Angular 20 is, as mentioned initially, that it is mostly about stability. Sure, there are some new features, and I'm sure we'll see many exciting new features in future major versions. The Angular team still is pushing forward, but it's important to also have a release that's mostly about stability, because you definitely don't want to end up with an ecosystem that's totally fragmented and where some projects are using super old syntax whilst other projects are using cutting edge features and lots of projects in between. So having some stability is well deserved and important, and I'm excited to see what we'll get in future Angular versions. But for now, we can all catch our breath and use the exciting new Angular features that have been introduced in the previous couple of major versions.